in a YouTube video and a podcast all at the same time, because the topic we are talking about is very important, and I wanted to make sure I'm Brittany on the platform that I tend to talk about this topic. So welcome back to episode 3 of this podcast. Today is going to be a solo episode without Kenneth. Brittany will be my co-host this time around. So we will be talking about injury and addiction with my friend Brittany. So if you want to stick around and hear about that, please do. And welcome to Disability Deep Dive. Brittany, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yes. Hi, Anna. Thank you so much for having me today. My name is Brittany Rieman. I am a spinal cord injury. I have a T12 incomplete, and I'm paraplegic due to a car accident. I got that car accident by being under the influence of drugs and alcohol, March of 2018. So it's been 3 years now. And since then, it's given me a new way of life. It got me clean and sober, and it's gotten me to wear this beautiful crown on my head. I am Miss Wheelchair Maryland 2021. I'm getting my sash clean, so I don't have my sash on. But yeah, and you know, I'm excited that you've asked me to come and share and talk to you today. So thank you for having me.
Yeah, that's cool. And I found Brittany through BBS. For the few who don't know that. The women's society I'm in stage one, and Brittany is in stage three. So I'm happy I found you. So my first question is, I know you have a spinal cord injury and are a recovering addict and mother. Do you want to explain your journey with all that?
Yeah, so I am a recovering alcoholic and addict, and through this life of this disability, so before my disability, I used drugs and alcohol to cope with everyday life. I had a pretty traumatic childhood. I'm the oldest out of 6 children, so I grew up pretty quickly. I have both my mother and my father were alcoholics and addicts, that's pretty much my realm. That's all that I really knew growing up. I didn't really know any different. However, you know, through my teenage years, you know, I was able to open up a little bit more. But then by my early 20s, after I had my first 2 children in a really bad relationship, my alcoholism and my addiction just rampaged. And for my 20s all the way up till my 30th, but you know, my 29th birthday was when it really started to really get bad. I went to jail. The 30th, I went to a mental hospital, and the 31st, I was recovering from having a car accident due to drugs and alcohol. So really this spinal cord injury saved my life. And I'm a very grateful person of the wheels that I have underneath of me, because it gave me a whole new world and a whole new life. And, you know, to be honest, I wasn't okay with being in a wheelchair in the beginning anyway, because I was at that time a mother of 3. You know, I was working, I had a house, I had responsibilities, but I still was an addict. And even through my first year of me being disabled and being in this chair, I still suffered through my addiction, because I found out that, you know, having a disability and especially being in a wheelchair, you're able to get pharmaceuticals, and doctors just, you know, have no question. All you have to, you know, I manipulated a lot of situations, even though I was in pain, but my addiction and my mental, you know, aspects weren't healthy, and I was doing it for the wrong reasons. So I actually got clean and sober the day before my 1 year in my wheelchair. And so I'm 2 years clean and sober, and I'm 3 years in a spinal cord injury. And, you know, I don't think that that happened by coincidence. I think that that was supposed to happen. I think I was supposed to go through these situations to get to where I am today. You know, as a woman that's a paraplegic and a mother, and, you know, I work and I, you know, I'm in recovery. Like, it gave me a whole new perspective of the way I can live my life. And today I live my life to the fullest. You know, I was crowned Miss Wheelchair Maryland of 2021. And, you know, this is an organization that doesn't look about beauty. It's about what's on the inside, and it's about, you know, empowering women and giving women a voice on what they are passionate about. And I come to find out that I was passionate about my recovery and how I got to this point in my life. And, you know, it helps the disability community as well as the able-bodied community. And I say that because, you know, I came in as an able body. I was an able body for 31 years. And so that's what I knew. And now, you know, I'm on the aspect of the disability community. So for the able body to understand, like, this can be you if you decide to use drugs and alcohol. This can happen to you if you don't die. You know, spinal cord injuries happen pretty significantly on a regular basis. So every day, you know, it can happen to anybody. Anybody can be put in the situation that I was put in. And a lot of people do. And then also, it gave me an understanding of the disability community not having the resources that they need for recovery. Because I work a 12-step program. So I go to meetings in churches and rehab centers and recreational places. And some of these places aren't handicap accessible. Now, I go because I need this thing. So I'll have people pick me up in my wheelchair, carry me up the stairs. You know, I'll get to where I need to get to work on myself. However, that's not the case for everybody else. So me being able to be a disabled woman in these rooms, I don't see a lot. I know one other person in my area that's in recovery and that has used a wheelchair, but she doesn't use it full time. So, you know, I am now in a position to where I'm showing my recovery community that, you know, one of our principles is the only requirement is a desire to stop using. And that means the only requirement is a desire to stop using. It doesn't matter how you get there, what your abilities are, what your status is, you know, just the desire to change and have a new way of life. So I want to make sure that the disability community is open to that in my area. So I've also started a nonprofit, and it's about 12-step recovery, but, you know, also it will be an accessible area for people with disabilities so that we want to make sure that all are welcome. So I'm kind of mishing up, you know, my recovery community with my disability community, because it all links in. We all need each other. And that's that's what this disability has given me. The spinal cord injury saved my life. And I'm very grateful for that. So, you know, with all of the things that I'm doing, you know, I also work for Centers for Independent Living, and I'm a peer support specialist. And I'm a peer support specialist for people in nursing facilities. So I'm trying to lead example to let people with disabilities know that you can have a good, successful, independent life, whatever disability you have. So it, like I said, it's given me a whole new perspective and a whole new world that I'm truly in love with.
Definitely. I learned to be more. Having a disability really opens up your view for certain things. Accessibility and accessible program. It doesn't matter what program it is, but most programs are not accessible. And then it also opens up to whoever will be there for you.
Right.
Like, I've had people, like, I have mental health problems as well, you know, and, like, sometimes I have really bad days, and people who are there, but then there's people who walk out on you with no explanation. So, and I was able to, when I was 19, I'm 20 now, I was able to find a community to bound say an adaptive beauty with another paper mill.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and you know, it's amazing to me that the program you were talking about would not be automatically accessible.
Right. And I mean, it, you would think that, but the thing is that, you know, within this recovery round, there's a lot of people that have came in that, you know, I mean, these things aren't talked about unless somebody is making, right. You know, as everything else, you know, things don't get fixed unless somebody's talking about it. So there might have been a lot of people and, you know, that have said something and have voiced something. And in that area, they've been able to fix that. That just so hasn't been in my area. So, right. You know, having that voice and being able to get your all of your information, like collect all your information, like I'm trying to go to all of the churches and all of the facilities that we host, you know, our recovery meetings at, and making sure that they are aware that, you know, just because it says that the bathroom is, you know, accessible, it sometimes isn't. You know, right. There's a lot of times where I can't use the bathroom in the church because the handicap stall is this big, but it's long. So, you know, making people aware of the options to better them, like not saying, oh, you're not handicap accessible and da 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 da. It's more of educating. And I'm educating myself to educate others. So I'm trying to take, right. You know, these experiences that I see and that I'm going through and being like, hey, are you aware that there's a possibility that you can get these things fixed through these grants through the state? Or, you know, I'm a small individual. I was 4'10", 120 pounds before I was in this chair. And there, you know, that's a small wheelchair. I have a small little wheelchair. Right. You know, you're not thinking about the motorized wheelchairs that are actually, you know, a bigger radius at the bottom, and that, you know, people having less, you know, I have my ability to use my upper body, you know, that's not the case with everybody.
Right.
So, you know, and if somebody wanted to come in, because being a disabled woman and also having a substance abuse issue, like I go through pain all the time, right. Every day. It never stops. I take medication that is non-narcotic, and that doesn't change who I am. Doesn't alter my personality, because those narcotics, once it gets into your body, your brain doesn't understand that, oh, it's just supposed to help you for this long. Sometimes it's like, oh, I like this feeling, let's keep it. And then it just prolongs, and then it becomes an obsession, and then it becomes denial, and then it becomes a full-blown addiction. For some, not for all. Some people are able to take their medications as prescribed. I am not one of those people. So for me to have these issues and not be able to get to my support groups, I would probably go back out, because that's all that I know. I wouldn't know the enjoyment and the success that other people are having these meetings and being able to be a part of something, just like when we have our disability support groups and, you know, our individual like disability issues, and we connect with those same people that have our same disabilities. It's the same thing in recovery. We have to know that these other people that have these substance abuse issues are getting through these things, and how are they doing it? And, you know, having a pain and having pain management and like those are things that need to be talked about as well, because that's a real thing. People struggle with that. Right. So yeah, it's just bringing awareness to these things and in a good manner and in an education manner, and not as a pointing a finger and disgruntled. Right. And I mean, it is disgruntling and it is discouraging and it is frustrating, but there's such a way to go about it, because, you know, you can, it's a sweeter taste with honey rather than vinegar. I don't remember the whole saying, but you know, I would rather be enticed with honey rather than vinegar. So
yeah,
I think it's just, you know, it's just my place as of right now. You know, there might be some areas, and then also, you know, people that are deaf and people that are blind, you know, making sure that they might have to need an interpreter, or we have, you know, our literature is of, you know, on audio, and if Braille, if they use it, you know, things of that nature, like just having that adaptive situations to where anybody that wants this recovery aspect and wants to learn how to live a life without drugs and alcohol, they can do that.
Right. I really, really appreciate you making your program accessible. That's why I started my YouTube channel and my podcast. So many things are not accessible for me. I don't know if you looked at my Instagram or not, but I'm in a walker, and I am just my third time new mobility device, and I am 4'8", about 98 pounds, but I think my mom and her won't be able to move me very much longer, so once I'm into adulthood, I'm going to need more places to be accessible.
Absolutely. So whichever way we can get these words out, whether it's, you know, and it's right, because I'm going to these churches and to these recreational places, and we're just using it for an hour out of the time. They could benefit their facility for the long run, so that they do have accessibility for anybody that wants to come in their facility. Like, that's the bigger picture. Like, I'm making what I'm going through just to make sure that it's best for everybody involved, you know, not just myself. It's not just about me. You know, there's other people that are struggling with this and that don't know the right ways to go about it. So, you know, if there are a few that can go ahead and voice, like, you know, it's not just me, it's people's in walkers. It's making sure you have audio. It's making sure you have sign language or something to make sure everybody feels a part of. We don't want to be left out because we have this one thing that not a lot of people have.
Right. And like, I know a lot of people who are completely quiet about advocating, and then like, you know, you could be living a better life if you said something like so my next question is, I know in a life with LA, you mentioned that sometimes when you are recovering, doctors make you painkillers that seem like the only option to feel better. But you oftentimes, when you thought it's hard to make awesome, what would you say to people in that scenario now?
So the pain medicine, it's really on you know, with me, I use my pain medicine. Like, pain medicine is supposed to last you all month. You're supposed to take it as prescribed. I wouldn't do that. My prescription would be gone in 2 weeks because I could not mentally put myself in, I just need this for my pain. So, you know, and I didn't feel as much of my, you know, my first year, I was very numb to a lot. I still had a lot of pain, but I was very numb to the reality of what nerve pain and paraplegia does to you. So when I was actually coming off of the medicine, it was the very hard. I had withdrawals, I felt like I was dying, and I felt my disability for the first time for real sober. And that was very, very hard, very hard. Everything was heightened. I wasn't used to the pain and tingling, the numbing, the burning. And it never stopped. And it still hasn't stopped, but now it's more of, you know, I do healthy let outs. I definitely, my support system was a huge thing through that, because I felt like I was dying, you know, but luckily through, you know, opiate withdrawal, you cannot die over, you know, coming off of these things. Alcoholism, if you were going through withdrawals, you can die through alcoholism, but you can't die through opiate, you know, trying to withdraw from opiate. It's going to make you feel like you are, and you're high, and it's going to, but for like a week or so. But after that, I was able to talk to my doctors and let my doctors know, hey, I abused my medication. I can't do that. You know, can you help me figure out different medicines or if there's different medicines or ways that I can do this. So, you know, they prescribed me non-narcotic medication, and there was a couple of things that I liked that I didn't like, but I tried, and, you know, I didn't take them, you know, I took them as prescribed, and I knew that they weren't going to mess, you know, give me that high feeling. So that made me feel at ease. I also was very active in my therapy at the time, trying to build my body up and get stronger. And then meditation, you know, I did a lot of meditation, and I did a lot of, you know, when you're, because for me, my body's always buzzing. And then when I try to like work on those certain areas, it's very hard to focus because I have to tell my body to make these movements that aren't making these movements. So if I'm distracting my body and I'm distracting my mind, for me, that's been my help, is I've been able to be a part of the world. Like, I don't just sit in my, you know, sit in my home. Like, I go out and I spend time out in the sun, and, you know, I was in water. Water was a huge outlet for me, because in that water float, you know, free floating, and I was a strong swimmer before, and learning how to adapt to swim, that was very therapeutic for my body. I did massages in the beginning. You know, I haven't been too much. I was actually a massage practitioner before my injury. Wow. So I knew a little bit about massage and, you know, keeping the blood flow and like just understanding like what your doctors, like being vocal about, hey, I have this problem, help me. And my doctors knowing, and it's all in my, you know, file that I am a recovering alcoholic and addict. I do not take prescription. I do not take narcotics. So it's a mindset, and it's very hard because you're fighting very, very hard pain, but wanting to not use these substances anymore because it was taking so much more from me. So it's really, you know, talking to your support group, talking to your doctor, letting them know what you're going through, and, you know, just being aware of your body. And now I'm aware, like, I can't move the way I used to move. So like, I have to know, like, okay, my body's feeling a little bit bad today. I need to relax and let it go. And I, you know, I take my medication and I go outside and take a fresh breath air, and I lay down, and a couple of hours later, I feel better. Typically the time, you know, it passes. These pain and these anguish and these feelings of frustration and all of these things that are swirling, they pass. But you have to be aware of these things, and you have to vocalize and ask for help when you are struggling. The biggest thing is asking for help. And that's the hardest thing for a lot of people, a lot of people, because we don't want to feel burdened. We don't want to feel like, you know, nobody will understand. And we don't want to feel like we should, like we have to help. Like we can do this all by ourselves. There's some things we can do by ourselves, but there's some things that we do need to ask for help for. And that's just the biggest thing. And that's just for me. Now, you know, I know other women that have a spinal cord injury, and they do things differently. And that's okay, because that works for them. It's just finding your niche, but being vocal about what you want.
Right. Every disability is different. Every person is different. And the I want a message, like, don't automatically do something to someone just because we might be in a hospital, in a wheelchair, or just like we might need help. Because sometimes the way we do things may look a little weird. I know the way I do things look like I'm completely out of my mind. But I end up getting it done, you know?
Right, yeah. And that's, you know, that's the adaption of this thing. Like, you know, a lot of people ask me, I drive. So I, you know, a lot of people see me break down my wheelchair, put it in the car, and everybody asks me, oh, you sure you don't need my help? It's going to make it longer for me to explain to you what I want you to do rather than me just do it myself. Right. So there are certain things that, you know, that I want to do, but, you know, not taking it upon yourself to do it. You ask first. Right. Just like how we have to, you know, people ask, do you need help? And I say, no, I'm okay. And then after that, if they decide to do more, then we'll talk. But typically you say, no, I'm okay. And they go, and they're like, okay, right. You know, I don't have to explain myself. I don't have, just because I have a disability doesn't mean I need everybody's help. I'm a very independent person. I do a lot of things on my own. However, I have to have some humility too. And I have to have some humbleness too. And there are some things that I do need help with. And I need to, and I've been better at doing that, but it's still hard. It's still very hard to ask for help.
Yeah. I mean, my Brittany said, it's going to take a wonder to ask you to help me. Or how to do that thing if you automatically want to do it. Because I have a speech impairment. And that you know me super well. It's gonna take you a while to understand what I'm saying sometimes. So that's where I prefer to ask for help when I need it. But asking for help can be very difficult sometimes. It also depends who you are asking.
Yeah, very true. Yeah, knowing the people to ask sometimes, you know, is a big thing as well. But, you know, and see with my, and see with me now having a disability myself, like, because you have a speech impairment, like, I'm able to recognize that there's more than just, you know, a spinal cord injury. So being patient and letting people, you know, voice their opinion, even regardless if they have a speech impairment or not, but paying attention to those things, because that's, you know, that's your daily life. That's how, that's the struggles that you go along with. And to be honest, I can understand you very well. So you sound wonderful.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yep. That's my other thing. I subtitle all my videos for people.
Yeah. And see, and that's another thing too, because I never thought about that before this either, you know, or, you know, I've seen a lot of videos to where people are blind, you know, once they start introducing themselves, they'll describe themselves of what they look like. And, you know, that's new for, you know, that's an amazing thing to do too. Like just those little acts of kindness to just make sure that other people are, you know, are aware that I see you, I hear you, you know, that feels so good.
Yeah, and like for my podcast, I posted on YouTube too, so I can add some title. And I direct people to that. So my last question is, I know you recently started a nonprofit for those with injuries. Do you want to talk about your journey when starting that and your mission and doing for it?
Yeah, so this actually is called the Great Escape Recovery Lounge, and we're a nonprofit corporation. Our purpose is to, you know, further the message of 12-step recovery, whether it's AA, NA, GA, Celebrate Recovery, any kind of 12-step program. We want sober events, fellowshipping. We also want to offer the individual membership for people that want to be in this club. It's a clubhouse, and I butchered my mission statement all up, so I apologize. But we through this pandemic, this is how it started. So we meet in these churches and recreational places and things of that nature. The pandemic shut everything down, and addicts had a really hard time with that. Now Zoom is great, but our personal interaction with each other and like being there and, you know, feeling the feelings, like, as we all know, you know, you can't feel too much through, you can do as much through the virtual, but when it's person to person and actually feeling that, you know, that passion, it's a little bit different. And in the recovery aspect, we depend on those meetings, you know, in person. So there was a lot of people scrambling, but we also understood the significance of this, of COVID. So a lot of things got shut down, and a lot of addicts lost their lives, and a lot of people that were trying to get clean and sober didn't have anywhere to go, and the Zoom wasn't doing it for them. And so we were actually, it was actually towards the winter of last year. We were outside at a meeting. It was raining. It was cold. And we knew of a couple areas. There's a couple areas and, you know, different states and stuff that actually have clubhouses that do this, that have a specific building that is fully for recovery. So from the time that they open up their doors to the time that they close, it's nothing but meetings, recovery, people in recovery, anything like that, a place to where people need a safe spot. So we and a couple of like four or five other alcoholics and addicts were there, and we just said, you know, we don't have one in our area. And I live in Maryland. And so I'm actually about like 30 minutes away from DC. I'm about an hour over, like maybe 45 minutes over to Virginia. Like I'm in the Mecca. I'm really in the center of Maryland. And I'm like an hour away from Baltimore. So our area doesn't have one. Now, our mission is to find a building. We're still in the beginning processes. We had one fundraiser in the fall, and it was great. And we're just trying to build something. We're trying to make sure that through pandemic and through, you know, all of these things, that we have a safe spot to go, that we have somewhere where we can meet and we can be to where there's no drugs and alcohol. Because for a newcomer, it's really hard. Somebody that is just getting clean and sober, they don't know that you can have fun without using those things. So, you know, we need a spot to lead by example. And so that's our mission, is to have 12-step recovery, whatever it is, however you get your recovery, to be able to have those doors open for those people. So like I said, we're in the beginning stages. We're fundraising. I think we have a motorcycle run event here coming up soon. And then we're also going to be doing a dinner later on this year, you know, and making sure that we adapt to the COVID and to the pandemic issues and regulations, like making sure that we're still safe. But this is a new era. This is something that's not leaving anytime soon, that I feel like. So we need to make sure that we are protected, because a lot of these churches didn't open back up to us. A lot of these churches that have been holding meetings for 15 plus years have been like, you know, I'm sorry, but we don't want people here anymore. So a lot of meeting places have been shut down, and we can't have that. You know, we need somewhere where to go. And because, you know, I have a disability, it's going to be something to where it's all inclusive for anybody. Right. So it's going to make sure that we have ADA regulations, good ADA regulations, making sure that it's really up to par. You know, if we need an elevator, if we need one level, or, you know, our literature, or, you know, looking into all aspects like that, that's a big thing on that. Yeah. And that's kind of what I'm trying to push into that. And that's what I can bring to the table, to the board. You know, it's a wonderful organization already. I'm so grateful for the people that I work with, because these people are friends, and I've learned from them. Hold on one moment. I'm doing something. Yeah. Sorry, children. But you know, I really am appreciative of all of these people that I've been a part of, because they've helped me learn and educate, you know, and give me the knowledge of, you know, what we can do, and, you know, leading by example. So I just want to lead by example, and I just want another place for people with disabilities and people with substance abuse issues can go.
Definitely. I will put all that, if you want to send it to me, Brittany, I'll put it in the YouTube and the podcast. No, for everyone out, if there's something you might be interested in or might find helpful. So thank you so much, Brittany, for your time. Tune in next month to the podcast and my YouTube channel for an interview with another BBS Natalie. How do you say her last name?
Don't ask me. I'm not going to butcher her last name.
I would say Natalie, who I interview about disability in the Asian American culture. So YouTube, gonna make the video